Okay, thank you. I'm Johan Samsing. We're very happy that this school is finally happening. I was talking with Jonah about this morning. None of us has really been seeing anybody besides you know, each other for the last year. And suddenly we're going from a 1 to 100 with suddenly 50, like 40 people showing up. So it's so exciting, and we're so happy to meet real people again. And of course, we're also very happy for all the people that are joining online. And I also wanted to say that if any of you want to, you know, explore Copenhagen different ways, please come and talk to us, me and Dan or Martin. We have many different things to do, or we will also do things ourselves. Maybe we'll go out to get food or snacks somewhere. We'll go to the lakes or other things. So sometimes we'll maybe post something on Slack saying, oh, we're going here, we're going there. So please come and join us. Maybe we find a meeting spot and so on. So please don't sit at the home and work on your, you know, like assignments during the night or during the afternoon. Please come out and talk to us. And that is why we are basically here, right? So I will make the first talk here, which is the introduction to gravitational waves. And as Dan said, we are very, very lucky. We are living in exceptional, exciting times. This is the map that many of you have seen. And this is, let me see if I can I hide these people up there? Dan, do I know how to do that? Just two minutes. Like this one, like this. No, it's not hidden. Ah, it's not online. Okay. So this is map of all the binary black holes, or black holes that we have seen up to, I think, 02 here. So I couldn't find a completely updated version of this. Like, we keep publishing new, you know, events popping out of the data that they also observe for 03. But as you see here, many of the black holes that we knew just a few years ago before LIGO was operating are the one in, sorry about that, are the one in that you see with the purple color. And that's observed with the electromagnetic radiation, just 2 seconds, from X-rays. Oh, sorry about that. Sorry about that. What do you say? Oh, actually, I think they asked us to use this tracking thing on the, so people online can see it. It's good that you say it, so I will enable it. Okay. Oh. Should I turn that one off? Or? Oh. Sorry about that. Okay, we'll just. Okay, sorry about that. Like this. Okay, and then like this. Is this? Okay. Well, my name is. Okay, so this is what we have at the moment. And there is a lot of things. So we are only looking at the masses here, but still a lot of information, a lot of interesting questions that we can already start to ask and actually see from this figure here, right? So you can ask basic questions about what is the maximum mass of a black hole that you can get? What are the different pairings that you expect to see? Do you expect more to see equal sized black holes merging with each other, or heavy or light? Is that weird if a very heavy merges with a light one? Is it very weird that you have two merging with each other, which is maybe more likely than two heavy merging with each other? And what about something like the spin and so forth that then we'll come into, right? So the basic question that I'm working on is from the astrophysical side. That is, how and where do these binary black holes merge? Right. And I would be very happy to talk with you about that during the workshop, because we really have no idea right now. It's us to find out. Dan and I working on this. Many people are working on that. And maybe some of you are already working on some of these problems. Yeah, you have a question. Oh, here? Oh, oh, you thought it was a very weird object with a minus, with a negative mass. Yeah, that is a very good point. So I'm using this one here, so people also online. But that was a good one. You take that one. Some of the things that that I would be very happy to talk with you about later are some of these very exotic objects. So it doesn't look so exotic. This graph here. So as you notice, the y-axis is in the log. But you can actually form these extremely massive black holes here. And some of the progenitors to these two here are actually like above the maximum mass that people predicted through isolated stellar evolution just a few months back. So there are a lot of exciting things in this figure here. We don't not only have mass to look at, we also have the spin and we have the eccentricity. So this here shows a picture of the mass. You also have spin. This is a picture from one of Carl Rodriguez's papers. And what you see here are two black holes, each having a spin. So when I'm talking about the black hole, spin is really the spin of each black hole here, right? You don't measure to leading order the individual spin of the black holes. You measure what is called chi effective, or the projected spin along the angular momentum vector of the orbit here, right? So what you really measure is this green arrow here. So the things that people go out and measure them and they talk about, oh, this is a really weird spinning black hole system, is really the projection of the black hole spins along the angular momentum vector. So you can ask things about, are the black holes spinning preferentially like along the same axis of the angular momentum, or are they misaligned, or are they randomly orientated and so forth, right? So for example, in clusters, we're gonna be talking about with black holes pairing up through chaotic interactions. It's not very likely that the spins are correlated, right? So you might end up with these isotropic spin distributions. So the distribution of chi effective will be distributed around zero, where if you have binaries forming in the field, for example, maybe you're more likely to have the spins aligned or closely aligned or correlated with the angular momentum vector, and therefore you are skewed to one of the sides in that distribution, right? So people are very interested in trying to map out this distribution. The eccentricity we'll be talking more about, so we'll come back to that. So it is up to us to figure out how to use these observables to figure out where these binary black holes are coming from. So some of the things that people are talking about at the moment is that they could come from the field. Maybe you just have two stars forming black holes. They being in an orbit, they evolve over, you know, less than a Hubble time, and then they merge. You can also have primordial black holes. A lot of people like to talk about that. Black holes forming around Big Bang, they interact with each other over Hubble time, and maybe some of them will merge. You can have clusters, very, very dense stellar systems where the density can not be, you know, a million times higher than a local solar neighborhood here. And in those clusters, you might have a few black holes, but because the interaction times, the dynamical times of these clusters is so relatively small, the black holes can fall to the center on a relatively short time scale. Because they're much heavier than all the other objects, they interact, strongly interact, and they those interactions will lead to a merger. I will show a few movies about this and talk more about that tomorrow. You can also have galactic centers. Naturally, people have been talking about this. You have a lot of stellar formation in galactic centers. They're very heavy. All the objects that you have in a galaxy close to the galactic center will be in a very, or many galaxies have a very, very dense nuclear structure core, and interactions will be frequent, and maybe that can lead to mergers. Galactic disks, AGN disks, have also become slightly popular recently. We'll be talking more about that. You have the supermassive black hole here in the center, and you have this disk of gas around, and maybe in that gas disk you have black holes forming. Maybe the gas disk is capturing black holes from the area around them. And the gas gives some drag to these black hole motions, and that will lead to a much faster merger than if you had to wait for gravitational waves to carry around the energy. So that can also speed up some of the merger processes and thereby lead to a higher merger rate. Or it could be something completely different, right? And that is up to us to figure out right now. We have no idea what's going on out there, but we are all trying to find different ways of telling the differences between the different channels here by exactly trying to map to the observables that I showed you just before, the mass, spin, and the eccentricity. Okay, so we're going to go a step backward here. So this is an introductory lecture here. So we're going to ask, what is it that we actually are measuring in this problem? We are measuring what is called the strain. This is basically the relative change in length between, for example, two points here. You have point A and point B. This is LIGO. Jonah will talk much more about this. The relative change in length is delta L over the length between the two points here. So as the gravitational wave has been produced by the source, the wave will propagate out. We'll talk more about that propagation. It will hit your detector here. It will give rise to a relative change, and that change can be observed. Okay. And all the information that you get for these binary black hole mergers, neutron stars mergers on the gravitation wave side, is encoded in the gravitation wave strain, which you map as a function of time. Okay. So what can that information be? So of course you can figure out what kind of objects that you're actually looking at. It is not that simple. We have all been trained now, all learned how to look at these figures here, right? So this here, we all know this is a binary system and it merges within some finite time. And we often split this into different parts. You have the inspiral part, right? So when we talk about inspirals, it's something that happens almost in the classical limit. They're still disconnected to objects, two neutron stars, two black holes, difficult to see in the waveform here, but they give rise to this sinusoidal signal. Okay, then they come closer and closer, and then they actually undergo what is called the merger here. And then we have the ring down where the objects, the two objects that merged, settle into some final state. And that is exactly what was observed here with the LIGO. And you see the animation here. And it was only during the last 15 years or so that people have been able to explore this with full GR. Right? So you might think it's like, oh, we had Einstein's equations for 100 years, must be easy to solve, but then not very easy to solve when you're in very strong GR, when you have the merger of the two black holes. People have been calculating how the inspiral phase should look like, and also the ring down, which is just a perturbation to a black hole. But the merger itself, was basically an open question until only about 15 years ago, where Franz Pretorius and others figured out how to solve this problem with supercomputers. Okay, but there's still a lot of work to be done here, because as I said, you can have different masses, different spins, eccentricities, many other things. Covering that whole space and looking for data like this in LIGO is an enormous amount of work. And it's almost impossible to sit and simulate all these different configurations. So people are trying to use mixing analytical theory with numerical simulations to get these template banks as fast as possible. Yeah? Yeah? Oh, yeah, for some reason, when I push backwards, it don't go backwards, sorry for that, but it has this spike here, yeah, exactly, yeah, so it's like when you have the boost, that was basically the strain that you saw these ripples, yeah. I don't know. Okay, so you can also see the difference between different object types, right? So as I said before, you can have point masses moving around that give rise to these signals. Up to the right, you see the clean black hole merger signal. Down in the bottom here, you see a signal from neutron stars. As you see here, the first part is very, very similar. The two objects are still very distant from each other. You don't see a big difference between black holes and neutron stars in this case here. But as they get closer and closer and closer here, you start to perturb the objects in the neutron star case. And the first order effect that you get is simply that these are not spheres anymore. They start to couple through higher order moments. And that can actually, that will change the inspire rate. That will make them merge a little bit faster. And you can see that in the strain signal. When they get closer and closer and closer, then of course you need full simulations to resolve this problem here. And then you get like a mix of the two neutron stars. And this, the what you would in the black hole case would call the ring down is much more complicated. You have this mix of the two neutron stars trying to settle into some state And what is the final outcome? It's not clear. Is that another neutron star? Will it blow up, or what is the outcome? Right. So people are looking at this also as a function of the neutron star mass. Okay. And then you can also get information from the spin. I will not be talking too much about this in this lecture here, but since the spins, they can couple to the angular momentum vector of your orbit. The orbit can also change slightly, and that is what you see up here. And this, and the signal strength, you can say, from the gravitational waves depends on where you see them from, right? So if the orbit start to change, you will have modulations. So this is over a much longer time than we have the other one, but you have will have modulation of your gravitational wave signal that also depends on the spins of the black holes. Right? This is an extreme case. For other cases, you don't see this much, but you will be able to map it out to leading order, for example, for the signals that I showed you before, through this Sky effect. Okay. And last, you have the orbital eccentricity that will give rise to completely different gravitational wave signals. This is also a relative highly eccentric source. It starts out with an eccentricity of 0.5. And what the biggest difference is that, so if you have two black holes that are just moving around each other like this, you can imagine that you have more or less like homogeneous radiation of gravitational waves over each orbit. But if you have highly eccentric, then over each perisinter passage, you have like a boost of gravitational waves, because that is where the two black holes are closest to each other. And those boosts are basically what you see here. Doom, 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 right? So that's basically a mapping also of the orbital time of this system here. At some point they circularize, and then you end up with a signal that's very close to the circular one. Okay. And this is a chance to show this movie here. We had a summer school a few years ago. Mike Sevin was doing his PhD at Sierra. He did a project with me, and we are looking at how to form these highly eccentric mergers, because many of you have probably learned, which is also true, that gravitational radiation tends to circularize sources, right? So how can you get these eccentric sources? So you can get it if there are other objects coming in and perturbing those binaries that are either about to merge or you know, are already about to merge within the Hubble. Yeah, a question? I have a question about the eccentricity. Yeah, the eccentricity, yeah. And how it detectors perpendicular to the object. Yeah. Well, we will see eccentricity. We can see eccentricity. There are some limits to how good we can see the eccentricity, of course, and that depends on many things. For example, the template bank, how well you do that. But also, you will find that the luminosity of your gravitational waves that you might be able to pick up with, for example, LIGO, will go down for the eccentric sources, because the power is spread over many more frequencies. So maybe, I don't know if Jonah can give a better answer on that later on, but there are many challenges when you start to get away from this circular case. We can talk more about it, yeah. Okay, so let's think about what kind of systems can actually produce gravitational waves. We go one more step backwards, okay. So what people normally say is that, well, that is bulk motion of a mass, something moving around. Luckily, nature is not giving us these complicated structures that you see through the lift here. Nature naturally gives us more or less spherical objects, at least when we have something that's very compact. Okay. And we can say, well, we all know it's you know, relatively compact objects that are generating gravitational waves, but you can still imagine objects moving in different complicated ways. You can imagine structures of objects and so forth. So how do we even approach the system or this problem here in a simple way, right? And what people normally do is to express this problem here in what's called moments, right? So if you have a distribution of mass, instead of just saying, well, I'm just going to integrate over all the, you know, freedoms of the mass, how it can move, you will never get anywhere, right? But if you split the problem, in this case, the distribution of mass, into what's called moments, you will actually be able to do some very simple, you will be able to write out some very simple equations which hold very accurately for many, many systems. So that is what we're going to look at right now, right? So you all know about moments. So if you have a general distribution rho of r, then the zeroth moment is just a total amount, you can say, right? The first moment is the mean, the second moment is the variance. So if you have a Gaussian distribution, that's all what you need to describe that distribution. Nature is, of course, much more complicated. Well, black holes are actually pretty simple when you think about it, but it is the distribution of mass that can be complicated. You can have many black holes, different configurations, but if you really look at the systems that really radiate gravitational waves, they need to get close to each other, and the probability to have more than two objects being very close to each other at any given time is very small. So going to the lowest order moments are nearly always fine. So if we now move to the case of matter, you have the zeroth moment here. So rho here is now a distribution of matter. So the zeroth moment, so I just wanted to say that what we now say is that the distribution of matter, the movement, the bulk motion of that must be the one that is emitting gravitational waves. Okay, so we now say it has to be a moment that is able to vary, that is to leading order radiating gravitational waves. So now we go through the different moments and ask what is the leading order moment that we can see is allowed to vary. If that is allowed to vary, we can say to leading order that that will be the one that is that dominating moment in the radiating gravitational waves. Okay. So the zeroth order moment is simply just the mass, right? Is the mass allowed to vary for isolated system? Not really, right? So we can go to the next moment. It's the first moment here. So we just multiply r and here, right? So if we integrate over the matter times r, we get the center of mass. In the classical limit, that is not allowed to vary. So the leading order moment in radiating gravitational waves is not center of mass movement. And in that way, you can combine different things. And then when you get to what is called the quadrupole moment, get the lowest order, that will actually, its components I and j are not restricted to be conserved in the classical limit. So that is the one that to leading order will be able to emit gravitational waves. Okay, I don't know if that reasoning was clear, but you can come and talk to me about it later, or read about it other places. But it is a variation in the quadrupole moment that will give rise to radiation of gravitational waves, also higher order, but this is the leading order. So what kind of objects are actually able to generate gravitational waves? So if we now consider objects that are allowed to spin around this axis that I put on here, then a black hole spinning, will that emit gravitational waves? It will not, because it has no change in quadrupole moment. This one here, if it rotates around this axis here, let's say it's a highly spinning neutron star. If rotating around this axis here, well, it would be weird that it's looking like this, but if it's just some ellipsoids, some disk that is rotating around this axis here, it would emit gravitational waves because it has a non-vanishing quadrupole moment. What about this one eared Mickey Mouse here? That will also radiate gravitational waves. Even though that we put one more ear on the left here, so we have some kind of symmetry here, if this is too blobs here, it will also radiate gravitational waves. If you have a disk or a rapidly spinning black hole that will probably, you know, distort in this way here, it will not radiate gravitational waves. And if you go to this point here of two point masses orbiting each other, it will also radiate gravitational waves. It has a change in quadrupole moment, and we'll consider that case in much more detail. Okay, so maybe you think these examples are maybe why should we listen to these one-eared Mickey Mouse, but actually this is some of the sources people are looking for. The continuous gravitation wave signals that LIGO put out a paper on this a few weeks ago, they were looking for these signals. Actually, neutron stars with small mountains on the top could also be other sources, but neutron stars don't have to be perfectly spherical, right? They could have small properties in the crust on the surface. And when I talk about mountains, they're probably like a millimeter high or less than that. But if they just keep spinning very high rate and you have several of them or just a few of them and you monitor these systems here for a very, very long time, you might be able to build up enough signal So you might be able to say, okay, is there a continuous gravitation wave signal from this source or not, right? That corresponds to that little lump you had on it, right? So you can calculate exactly from this formula here that I had before, you know, next to works, you can calculate, you know, if you expand this example here, you can calculate exactly how much radiation you get from a neutron star and how long time you have to wait for this signal to accumulate to a observable value. Okay, so now we're gonna talk much more about the binary black hole case. That is the case that is most relevant at the moment. And I will go through a lot of equations now, some reasoning, and it will be hand-waving arguments. I was trying to find a word for that, but I will try to give you some intuition for where all the equations that we're talking about are coming from, right? Dan will expand on that later, actually using Einstein's gravity, where I will just be using the new from the Newtonian limit and work my way up to the merger time and so forth for both circular and eccentric sources. So as I said, it all starts with the quantum moment. We don't have to think about more complicated moments at the moment. So for a binary black hole, the quantum moment that I denote Q is just given by mR squared. Okay, it's just two delta functions and then the separation R. Great. So as I said, the strain which carries all the information is originating from some change in this quantum moment. Okay, but it must also scale with this distance in some way, right? So you have this strain, and you have some dependence on the distance from the source. You know, if we are infinitely far away, we will probably not be able to see it, right? If you're very close, you might be, you know, you will be perturbed very much by it. So it will have some dependence on the distance r to some power m. And then it will be in the change of the quantum moment that will be the leading order effect that will give rise to this strain. Okay, so we start out by writing this equation here with t is time. Okay. So first, we ask ourselves, what is the power of m? Well, so from conservation of energy, we find that the amplitude, so if you go into some classical, you know, book about wave fields, you find that the amplitude of a wave have to go as 1 over r, such that because you want, like, if you integrate over a sphere, you find that the energy is conserved. And that simply comes from that for any classical wave field, the flux, which is the energy per area per time, is given or is proportional to the frequency squared and the amplitude squared, okay? And given this, you find that the amplitude have to go as 1 over r, because if you want to integrate the flux over the whole sphere, you want to be conserved. In that case, you get the luminosity. A has to be of 1 over r. Associating h with r, you can then find that m is actually equal to minus 1. Okay. So now I have a little exercise for you. I want you to figure out what the value of n is. And notice we have not used dr, we have not used anything. This is just from basic principles. I want you to figure out what n is, given that the only constants that can enter this problem are the gravitational constants c and g. And I'll give you a few minutes. And you should also figure out what the combination of C and G is. And you should use that H has no dimension, right? It's delta L over L. That's the, as you remember. We have a question, what is the units of H? That has no units. H is proportional to delta L over L. So it's a relative change in length, yeah. So it has no units. Yeah. And free coffee for the rest as well. Somebody online solved it there, of course, also, you know, more than welcome to raise a hand, tell how they did it. Okay. Who's there? Yeah, so people should write the answer for N, or at least if they have the answer. Well, I will ask you how to, you got it, so you shouldn't just write it. It's a copy of it all. Okay, Andrew, Solomon, do you want to chime in with an answer here?
Yeah, sure. I got that N equals 2.
Yeah. That is correct. So I have Andrew here, but I cannot share him right now. This is not possible. To, well, I can see Andrew on my screen. Andrew, maybe you can just say a few words of what your thoughts were when you solved this problem here, and then we'll take it here with the people here afterwards.
Sure. So I started thinking like first about the Schwarzschild radius, which should be gm over c squared. And since that has units of length, I figured I needed to add some amount of factors of C to get rid of the R squared, to get rid of both that length and the R squared on the top. So I added two more factors of C on the bottom, which got rid of the lengths. But then that gave me a unit of times squared in the numerator. So I added, so I figured N must equal 2 in order to get rid of the times squared in the numerator.
Okay, yeah. So Andrew, you're free to mute again. Thank you. I'll go so did somebody here or somebody here able to solve it or? Yeah, great. And you used the same way. Yeah, great. It was great that you took your time to look at this. So this is one way of doing it. Andrew did a little differently. Here I write it out, brute force here. You could say H is proportional to something, you know, G times in some exponent alpha, C beta, R minus. First, we already know that. If we didn't know that, it's actually a little, I don't think it's possible to solve it. And then you have the mass is coming from this term here, right? You have something R squared, right? So the R is distance, C, G, mass, and time you have down here minus N, right? So these are the units that you start out with, and then you can play around with the exponents. So the units of G you can then write out, and the units of C you can write out. So they're all, you know, so you end up only with the units, I think, of, so M and R, for example. And then you say, well, all of the mass terms, the units there have to equal, or all the exponents, the if you take the sum of them has to equal zero. And again, you put out three equations, and then you solve for what n has to be. And the idea is simply just to write this out and then say this here must not have any dimensions, right? So this is one way of doing it. I hope that's clear. Or come and talk with me afterwards. The funny thing is that we have actually been able to calculate a formula for a strain just by using or just by looking at the dimensions of the problem here, right? So let's actually look at what the strain then turns out to be for a binary black hole. Here we have the change in quadrupole moment, and you see the change is with respect to time, right? So we can approximate this with our quadrupole moment for our system. Now I'll replace the distance r with a semi-major axis a. I normally work with that, so don't get confused. I just use that instead. And then the time at over which it changes must be the orbital time, right? The two objects are moving around to each other. If you're standing from somewhere and looking at it, the change must happen over that orbital time. So we replace now the delta t with t squared. And the t here is simply just the orbital time of your binary system. And just from Kepler's laws, a cubed divided by gm, then you end up with a formula. I just plug it in up here. You end up with a formula for h. This is going as g squared over c to the fourth power 1 over g, m squared over a. Right? And that can also be written in another form, where v is the orbital velocity of the two objects, and r is the Schwarzschild radius. So you can see here, for h to be as big as possible, you must be as close as you can get to the Schwarzschild radius. Well, okay, so it scales with the Schwarzschild radius, right? So your units are basically your gravitational units in this case here, right? So it's scaled with the Schwarzschild radius. So if you're standing 100 megaparsec away from the source, that's very, very big compared to the Schwarzschild radius of your source, right? And v must be very, very close to c. So for getting a large h, you must be in the relativistic limit, right? And as an observer, we are almost never that, but we can hope that the source at some point will get close to c, and that's what saves us in these equations, right? Okay, so if you plug in some numbers, two neutron stars merging at a distance of 100 megaparsec, h is about 10 to the minus 2. And that's a very small number, and I'm sure many of you have thought about this or heard about it. It's an extremely small number, and people normally put up an analogy saying, well, it corresponds to that you have to measure the distance to the nearest star with a precision of a human hair, right? You can think about I just was building a few things in my kitchen the other day, just measuring things within a centimeter over a couple of meters was kind of quite challenging to me. But if you have to measure the distance to the nearest star within a human hair, that's just unbelievable, right? Jonah is one of the people who can do it, so he will he will tell us about this later. Okay, so now we're going to talk about what kind of energy that's radiated away from this binary system, right? So you have the wave traveling out, the amplitude is given by this h here. You can observe it. It's difficult, but you can observe it. But what about the energy that it carries, and how does that energy radiation impact the evolution of the system? That's what we're going to look at now. Okay, so for a classical wave field, you have the flux, as I said, is proportional to the frequency squared. Before I had the amplitude squared, now we have the h squared. And as I said before, same way you can think about it before, if you now integrate over a surface and fix the units in front, as I said, we did before, then we can get an estimate for what is the luminosity of our gravitational wave source. Okay, that depends on C cubed or G. You can see suddenly the luminosity is extremely high, right? Strain is small, luminosity is high. H squared, F squared, R squared, okay? And now again, I want you to take a look at this formula here, and I want you to estimate what is the maximum luminosity that you can get from a binary black hole merger, and how does that depend on the mass of the black holes? Will you get most luminosity for very heavy black holes or small black holes, or what is the maximum luminosity. So please take a look at this. And the frequency here, I should say, to leading order, is just 1/1 the orbital time, right? So the frequency of the gravitation that you see, gravitation waves, is actually 2 divided by the orbital time, but just use 1/T. And remember the equation we had from the strain before. So can you estimate what is the maximum L and how does that depend on the mass? If somebody in this room has an answer, please raise the hand. Somebody has an answer? Or? Okay, we have one down here. Yeah. Seems if they agree. I'm not sure if that's correct. Let's. What do you say? Okay, we have here a bit of power to the fifth. We have other smaller and larger numbers. I don't think, no, it's not, no. It's not well. So the way that I'm thinking about it, right, is well, the maximum luminosity must be just when the two black holes are touching each other, right? And at that distance, how far are they from each other? They are Schwarzschild radius from each other. Then you can evaluate what is this quantity here when the two black holes are just touching each other, right? When they are GM over C squared from each other. Yeah, we have an answer down here, or a bit. It does not depend on the mass, that is true. And what is the, yeah, okay. That is absolutely true. The tricky thing, well, not tricky, but this is the answer. It does not depend on mass. It goes as a C to the fifth divided by G. Some of you might see this as the Planck luminosity. And as you see, in that way, binary black hole mergers are in fact very close to what you maybe call standard candles. And you can use this quantity to determine at the least the luminosity distance, right? You can measure the luminosity that you get from the gravitational wave in LIGO, for example, and you take the ratio with this one here that has to be around R squared, and then you find R squared, okay? So there is a way to measure the distance. The more complications because the signal is also redshifted and so forth. But if the sources are close, you can get the distance within a factor of unity by this approach, okay? So let's proceed and calculate what is the evolution of the system. And what we simply do here is that we can express the change in energy here, in terms of the change in semi-major axis, I just use the Kepler's law, okay? And I just take a change with respect to take the dA, dE, and then divide, you can say, like the t on both sides. That's one way of thinking about it. And then we use the dE, dt that we just calculated up here, okay? You can get that by plugging in the values for the strain, frequency, and so forth. And then if you plug that one in here, dE, dt, this is the change in energy from gravitational wave radiation. We get the change in distance between the two black hole semi-major axes. That's what we have here, okay? And okay, it turns out well on this screen here. So that, of course, gives rise to decay of the orbit. So as I said, all factors of order unity, even plus or minus signs, have really been omitted in these slides here. So the change is, of course, negative here. It becomes smaller and smaller as a function of time. And the rate at which it decreases is given by this factor here, right? So you can see that's a very, very small factor if you look at the front factor. Okay, so now it's quite simple to integrate up. Let's say that you want to find the merger time for a binary black hole, starting out with a semi-major axis A naught here. You integrate up this equation here, and it's quite easy to see that if you now solve for the case where AT is equal to zero, when the two black holes basically touch each other, then you know you have this one equal to this one. You solve for example, T, that's your merger time, and this one here gives you the you know, famous formula that the merger time goes as A to the fourth divided to by M to the three, okay. That's all coming out from the simple equations that we have gone through. Now I'll quickly go through the energy laws for eccentric binaries and see how that's gonna change the merger time, okay. So what we're gonna do here is, you can come and talk with me afterwards about this, I didn't put it in, but you can actually find that the radiation of angular momentum is much smaller than the radiation of energy. If you have highly centric orbits, that basically means that the inspiral happens more or less with a constant period in the distance. And therefore, you can calculate that the energy loss per orbit is approximately constant, okay? And you can calculate that energy loss by just replacing A, the equations that we had before, with the periods in the distance. This almost corresponds to an object that's, you know, on a circular orbit here with the semi-major axis equal to the periods in the distance. There are some front factors in front that takes care of that that's not entirely true, but all for all the scaling purposes it is right. Okay. And from that exercise, you find that the energy loss over one period in the passage simply is given, you can see in this term here where you have RP is the Pearson passage. Okay. And assuming that this one here stays constant over each orbit, you can calculate how long time it takes for that system to merge. Before we get into that, I just wanted to introduce the concept of these captures, right? So if you, for example, are in a very dense stellar system and you have two black holes that are encountering each other, you can, for example, through this formula that we found up here, you can see that in some cases, the two black holes might get so close to each other that they radiate more energy over the first passage that they actually have at infinity in this cluster, right? So here you can see that the cluster or some, you know, some distribution of black holes have a relative dispersion of V infinity squared or V squared. Therefore, the energy at infinity, the total energy between any two objects is about a half mv squared. If they radiate more than that energy over a single passage, you get a bound system. And that bound system will in most cases merge in a very, very short time scale. And those captures can happen in very dense stellar systems. I will talk more about tomorrow. But that's one of the simplest you know, mechanisms of or when gravitational waves start to kick in to these you know, highly dense black hole subclusters. Okay, so I said I'll talk about that tomorrow. Okay, we can integrate this equation up and we then from that find what is the inspiral time for eccentric binaries. Okay, and you have some front factor here and you have this extra factor that is out here. Okay, I must warn you, if you look in a textbook, it says 1 minus E squared to the 7/2. But in the high centricity limit, 1 minus E squared is 1 plus E, 1 minus E is 1 minus E. That's the leading term. We are only doing leading order Newtonian limit here. That is why you only see the leading term. The other one was just go out in there as a front factor, right? But this is to illustrate to you that the merger time of eccentric sources are greatly reduced when you have a non-zero eccentricity, right? So therefore, you can create binary black hole mergers either by having them to the two black holes very, very close to each other, where you start out with A to the fourth power or A very, very small to start out with, if they're very massive, or you can do it by excite the eccentricity. Smadars, you will talk much more about these Lidov cosi configurations where you have a binary with a third object bound to it that can perturb the eccentricity of the inner system. I have been working a lot on these chaotic interactions where you have binary black holes directly strongly scattering off other single black holes. You saw the other movie with binary scatterings. And in this case here, the eccentricity is excited to such a high value that you see here that the two black holes are simply driven to merger on an orbital timescale of the system, right? You see it here. So you start out maybe with a merger time of more than a Hubble time, the third object go in and keep perturbing until the eccentricity becomes large enough for the inspiral time to be comparable to the orbital time of your entire system, right? So you have variations of these different ways. Yeah, we have a question. Yeah. The time scale here is about a year or something. Yeah. The question was, what is the characteristic or what is the time scale of this simulation that we saw to the right? That's about a year. Okay. So these centric mergers that we have been looking at give rise, as I said, to very unique signals. So therefore, if you find these eccentric signals, maybe that's an indication of that the binary black hole merger has been assembled in an environment where there was at least one more object perturbing that. And that's a very useful information, since I said, for example, if you have two stars that are forming next to each other, they form two black holes, they merge, they don't necessarily have another object close by. So you might be able to tell the difference between different channels. I'll go more into this. Yeah, we have one more question. Yeah. Yeah, so we have a question. That's very good. Okay. Yeah, so we have a question here on what the mass ratio should be for these three objects in interacting for this mechanism really to be really being important. And you only get into this dance if you have more or less the same mass. Yeah. If one of them is very, very heavy, the other one would just come in, the binary, for example, would just come in, and then it will get perturbed by basically the tidal field. And you can excite the eccentricity in that process as well. You can also split it apart, right? So you can calculate what is the change in the orbital elements. Yeah, it's very difficult to change the semi-major axis actually without splitting things apart, but you can change the eccentricity. Yeah, we have a question here. Yeah. The orbit is not changing, but it's mostly the center of mass motion of the two. So you basically end up with two objects orbiting each other. The two objects that are merging, they're moving along the center of mass. But once they merge, then they will probably receive a gravitation wave kick, right? And that kick will kick that remnant out of orbit, or you can imagine it could kick it into the other one or get a merger. People like myself have been imagining all kind of weird situations that can follow these mergers. But it seems, things have to be very fine-tuned for something, you know, happening after the merger. So you mostly just see the merger and you probably don't really notice the third objects after the merger. Yeah. Okay, so I have a few last slides. I know I'm a little bit low on time here. So for the people that are here, you're free to talk with me 24/7. So if you have long questions, please wait for them after them. So let's take a look at what we actually observe. Okay, and see what we can use, all the things that we have learned, what we can use that for if we actually look at real data. Okay, so when we look at real data up here to the right, okay, you see we can observe the frequency, we can observe the time, you know, this is time in seconds. We can observe time differences, we can observe frequencies, we can see strain and so forth. We can read that off the figure. So let's see how the frequency change with time. Okay, we can combine the change in energy frequency just from Kepler's law. And we also know how the energy gonna change with time from our considered gravitational wave radiation exercises, okay? And from that, we can get an equation for how the frequency change as a function of time for inspiring binary black hole. We get some equation here. And then we can integrate that up to reach an equation saying, what is the frequency if at a given time t relative to the coalescence time c, okay? So we can go in and say, well, now we have a relation that relates the, you know, if we know the mass of the black holes and we know the time difference, for example, from here to here, that's about 1 second, then we should be able to calculate what the frequency should be, you know. But of course, we could go the other way. If we can read off the frequency and we just read off the time difference here, we can calculate what's the mass of the black holes. Let's try to do that. Before we do that, I need to put in some prefactors that I just completely skipped in this presentation. They actually end up, I think, being a factor of 100,000 in front here. So you know, look, you know, in your textbooks when you use these relations, but all the scalings are right here, right? So if you keep track of these things, you end up with a prefactor here. You plug in the data or the frequency and the time difference that you see to the right. And then you actually get that the mass of these objects must be around 35. You know, it depends on how you look at it. It could be 100, it could be 10, but isn't that ballpark, right? So that's actually quite amazing from the data itself, if you keep track of the real factors from this exercise that we have done here, we can actually estimate the masses of these objects, okay? So I just wanna give some final remarks here. Gravitational waves are produced for a changing quadrupole moment. All information is encoded in the strain, and radiation leads to energy dissipation and merger. Eccentric mergers give rise to unique signals, and eccentricity can also reduce the merge time significantly. The thing that I hope that we'll be discussing a lot on this workshop here is how and where do these binary black holes form. So I hope you will take all the time you have to talk with us and talk with each other. How we can use the way of thinking that I presented and the things that we hear about this week, how we can solve this question. So that's extremely exciting. And I will leave three small exercises here for the people who have no idea what to do in the evening here. Can you figure out how much mass that's lost through gravitational waves? Now, don't start with Einstein's equations. Start with the things that we have been looking at here. Can we determine the distance to the source? I gave you an example. Can you do that from the data? And can you estimate the gravitational wave kick for unequal mass black holes that are not spinning? Okay. So you must be able to solve these things just using these hand wavy arguments that I have given you here. So I hope that gave you a somewhat good feeling for how these equations are coming out, and you don't have to sit and look at the dusty test textbooks for 20 years to get an idea of how these scalings work out, right? So I hope that we'll have a great school here the next week, and please come and talk to us if you have any questions or ideas. Thank you. Technical question, yeah? Yeah, I will. Okay, uploading the presentation, I will. Yeah, so for the people online, I want to say that we will upload the presentations, and we also made recordings of all the lectures, and they will put them up by the end of the day, each day. Positive. By the end of the year. Yeah, with an normal time, yeah. Okay, we have one question here online. Are gravitational waves completely isotropic, or can the emission be beamed? So you can think about it. Yes, it can be beamed. It's not completely isotropic. Dan, he will talk a little bit about that. You have a beaming pattern from the gravitational waves. And that's also why you saw, for example, the modulation to the spinning binary black hole. You have the orbit slightly changing, and that gives rise to small change in the beaming. That's also why you get a gravitational wave kick. There's a little hint here for one of them. So during the final stages of the merger, the gravitational wave radiation is not completely isotropic, and that gives you some kind of kick in the final part of the orbit. So they're not isotropic, and Dane will clarify that a little bit in the next talk. There can be Doppler boost and lens that will, if you have other objects in front, but yeah. Okay, thank you.